record on this computer. Yeah, we're recording now. Okay. So I will, thanks for reminding me of that, Bridget. I'm a little bit nervous. So I have my notes in front of me. So I may still forget my script. So I'd like to first of all start by saying that you're all very welcome today to the Photography Club, which is part of the Bealtaine Festival at Home. And that it's really nice to see so many friendly faces here. And I hope that you're all going to come away from today with something that you can work with, or that you found interesting, or that maybe you found inspiring. So I've mentioned the recording. I also need to warn you that I share my house with a five-year-old, okay? And that there may be some ambient noise, very loud ambient noise. He's been warned, but, you know, he's a very short attention span. So just if there is, I have a set of earphones. I'll put them on if I hear them in the background, okay? And the same goes for you guys. Don't worry about it if it happens. Just let it happen. It doesn't matter. Just ignore it. So the next thing I'd like to do is, it's important to thank the people who made today possible and the sponsors. So today's sponsors that we owe a debt to are, first of all, Age&Opportunity, Creative Ireland, the HSE, and the Arts Council. So that's the, is that right? Have I got them all, Bridget?
Yeah, great. Thick.
And now I just need to tell you a little bit about myself before we get going. I should say I have a presentation and I'll be screen sharing with you. It's a little bit clumsy. I'll do my best to do it as smooth as I can, but I just ask you all to be patient while I'm doing that. We had a few technical issues last week, and hopefully they're the teething problems out of the way. But, you know, if there are, we'll just breathe deeply and relax and work through them. So just about who I am. My name is Brian Cooney, as you will know if you've seen the ads on the Bealtaine website or on Facebook or on social media. And as you can see, I've grown a beard since that photograph was taken, and I've grown my hair long. So this is a consequence of the environment that we're living in today. I'm a visual artist. I came to the arts late in life. I was 40 when I began to study photography. I studied for my degree with the Open College of the Arts, or as it's now known, the University for the Creative Arts. And I graduated in 2019. In 2019, I had the honor and the privilege to be awarded an artist residency by Age&Opportunity. The name of the residency was the Artist in Residence in a Care Setting, and it was based here in Sligo in a hospital called St. John's Hospital. It was a great privilege to be awarded it, and I learned an awful lot from it, to be honest. I found the people that I was working with very inspiring. So I think that's all there is to say about me. So now I'm going to do the first screen share. I thought, seeing as I'm trying to think about things or ways that, as a visual artist, I'm trying to share with you the ways that I keep my motivation going, that I keep myself being inspired or thinking about. So even if I'm not making images, I can keep on looking at images and learning from looking at images or reading about how people made images. So I'm going to go to the first screen share. This will be in the presentation. You don't have to write anything down or remember anything. Okay, you're going to get the presentation afterwards. It's a list of links. Actually, do you know what? We won't go to the links. We'll just go straight to the web pages. I'll share the web pages with you. But you might find it interesting. So I'm just going to screen share now. Share. Okay. So can you all see that page?
Yes.
Okay. So this is just a quick, there's half a dozen different things here. There's four things I want to share with you. This is an open call for photography that's made during this time of quarantine, okay? Anybody can enter it. You don't have to call yourself a photographer. You don't have to consider yourself a photographer. And it's a really simple open call. Means you can submit anything, okay? And you can be anybody. There's a very simple brief. The name of the open call is A New Normal, and the brief is: A new normal calls for photographers to respond to our current climate by using their medium to find joy hope and beauty in times of stress, anxiety and boredom. We want to see your best images made within 2 kilometers radius of your house. Beyond that, the criteria are open for your interpretation. To me, that's a fantastic brief. It leaves it wide open. You can stretch it any way you like. So our favorite images will be paired with a commissioned piece of poetry and published in an online gallery on the district website, as well as being featured in a printed zine as part of PhotoIreland's TLP editions. PhotoIreland's TLP editions. PhotoIreland are an organization based in Temple Bar. TLP is the library, the library project. That's what they call their base in Temple Bar, and they publish their own books. So you have the chance to submit your work to be part of a record of this time, and that to me is why I would be interested. It's not about accolades or awards or whatever. What I'm interested in doing is making work about the time that we're, the times that we're living in, making images that speak about now. Okay, so there's an opportunity for you. It's going to be in the notes that we're going to share afterwards, and if you fancy it, that then go for it. And just submit your images. Don't be afraid. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. So the next one is an article that I came across in the Guardian. Hang on. I'm just sorry if anybody has vertigo. The article is called "Through My Lockdown Lens: 11 Leading Photographers Capture Their Confinement." Okay. So there's a selection of photographers here. Now you might be asking yourself, why would that be interesting to me? I think as somebody who makes images, I'm always interested to see how, and I'm interested, as I said, in responding to the times that we live in. I'm always interested to see the sort of images that other visual storytellers make. And I'm always interested to see the sort of thought processes that they might be going through, or the things that they're struggling with, or the things that are going well. So this is a collection of very, Alex Soth, we're going to talk about Alex Soth later on. He's one of the people that I'm going to show you some work. Alex Soth is a stupendous visual storyteller. And there's a whole section in here about what he's making, why he's making it. Also, Vanessa Winship, another fantastic visual storyteller. Her work is just incredible. And so on. There's an Irish, I'll just skip down. This is Eamon Doyle. If anybody's come across Eamon Doyle, he's an Irish photographer, lives in Dublin. So that's another resource for you as well. It's going to be at the very beginning of the presentation that I'm sending around, or that we're sending around. The next two are two different accounts that I follow on Instagram. Okay. The first one is Mass Isolation Format, it's called. If you don't know, Format is a photography festival that happens every year in the UK, in Derby. And obviously it's not going ahead. So they've set up this online account on Instagram, and they're curating. It's like an online curation of work that's been put up on Instagram. And they're asking people that if you want to participate, you tag the work that you put up with these tags here. Okay. So it's hashtag Mass Isolation Format, Mass Isolation Derby Quad, and so on and so on. And then the last one is Mass Isolation Ireland. Sorry, Mass Isolation Project, which is, excuse me, Mass Isolation Ireland. This is them, if anybody's familiar with it, the Gallery of Photography in Dublin. This is their response to the current climate, the current lockdown. Again, it's an online curation. They are collecting and featuring images that are made by other people, and I've even had a few of my own. This one here is my image. So, I'm trying to contribute to the record of the times that we live in. Okay? I'm just going to come off sharing now for a minute. Does that make sense? Is everybody...
Yeah.
Does that make sense to everybody?
Yeah, sure,
yeah. Okay.
Yep.
So we're in a second we're going to go back to how many people have we got. We have 14 people. Okay, so I was going to ask everybody to say a few words about themselves, but 14 people is a lot of people to get through, so maybe what you could do you know what would be really helpful for me, if you could do it instead of me going around everybody individually, if you could have a think about what you would like to get out of these sessions, and send me your thoughts in a chat, And that would be really helpful for me when I'm putting together the last two or the next two. Okay. If you could tell me a little bit about yourself, your interest in photography, and what you might hope to gain by being here, then I can build the next two sessions with that in mind. Okay.
Yep.
Does that make sense? Okay.
Yeah.
I'm learning as I go along. Zoom is a weird place. I found it really intimidating last week. You know, I was I found myself looking at a sea of faces. And you know, if we were face to face, I would be ensuring that I get continuous feedback as I went through a presentation with you, or you know, if we did a workshop together. So I'm hoping that we can build that in. So the way I would like today's workshop to work is that we're going to look at some images. I have them in a presentation. As I said, it's about home. And I would like people here, if they could, to do some work as well as me. I'm going to ask you to, I'm going to tell you very little about the image. We will discuss it. But really what I'm trying to get at here is, every time that you look at an image, it says something to you. It speaks to you in a certain way, okay? And these images that I've chosen are open to interpretation. And what I'm hoping that you'll see is that they're open to multiple interpretations. So I'm going to be asking you things like, what does this image say to you? What can we tell about the person in this image? What can we tell about their relationship? And so on and so on. And don't be afraid. Please speak up. You know, put your spoke in. Don't be afraid. Don't feel intimidated. Everybody's opinion is equal here. Nobody has. There is no right or wrong answer when it comes to art. You know what I mean? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Now, so I've mentioned the inspiration. Now, the next thing that we're going to talk about, we're going to look at the work that was made in response to last week. Okay. And so I know that some of you weren't here last week. You'll get the brief, and if you feel like, yeah, if you have the time and you want to play with it, and I emphasize the word play, it's all about play. If you want to play with the brief from last week, have a look at the notes. There's a couple of videos. There's some examples of the work that I shared. And if you want to play with last week's assignment, please feel free to do so and submit it, and we can have a quick chat about it next week. So I'm going to go back to screen share for a second. And I'll just go to the presentation that I've got ready this week. Okay. So can everybody see that?
Yes.
Yeah.
So I'm going to start. Here are the list of links that I've already discussed. And then, so you'll be getting them in this week's presentation. So last week's assignment was on self-portraiture. And we got... besides myself, we had three participants who submitted work, and it's really, really good work, all of it. It's really interesting work. It's really good work. And I'm going to show the examples now. And as I show each one, I would like, if you don't mind, if each person would just say a few words. You don't have to say very much. Just say a few words about how you found making it, what it, you know, maybe what it means to you, and so on and so on. Okay. Is that okay?
Yep.
Okay, so the first piece of work was Bridget's piece of work. Can everybody see that?
Yep.
Okay, so I think this is, so Bridget sent me two, and I chose this because, I deliberately chose this, Bridget, because I like the fact that your eyes closed in it, okay? Would you like to say a few words about it?
Yeah, just to say I wasn't really... I suppose I was just playing around, and I thought the light was interesting, and I could tell that at a certain angle it gave me this really weird, almost cubist kind of angle on my face, and I just thought that was interesting. And you know, it brought to mind some of, you know, those quite famous images, Picasso and stuff like that, which, you know, to me is like, you know, like a mind that's not quite, it's just a little bit off at the moment. And that's kind of, I think, how a lot of us feel.
Yeah.
So just thought it was a good kind of representation of what's going on at the moment.
Yeah. I think it's a really interesting image because it's everything that we talked about last week. It's ambiguous. It's open to interpretation. I'm looking at it here and I can put my own interpretation into that. You know, it makes me wonder who you are. And for me, what makes a good image is an image that asks questions. You know, you have to work as the viewer to find a meaning in an image. Whereas, you know, if you give too much away, and we're going to talk about this later, if you give too much away in an image, it's somehow, it's easy to just move on. And you know, our eye doesn't stay on it very long. Thanks very much, Bridget. That's a great submission. So, moving on, Ed. It is Ed, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Yep.
Yes, thank God. Because I was calling you something else last week.
Uh-oh.
I was calling you a different name. I got your name wrong last week.
No, that's okay.
Would you like to say something about your submission, Ed, which is also very good? I love the book covers.
Oh, thank you very much. Thank you very much. I guess I'd say I actually found the assignment to be very challenging and in a good way. It's not that I've not experienced taking selfies, but actually, I guess taking selfies and thinking about what it says proved to be a little bit of a challenge for me. So I decided actually to construct something that I think reflected some of the sort of skills and abilities that I have from my work profession. I was a librarian for 30 years,
right.
And a retired librarian now. And sort of in librarianship, you learn to sort of make connections between pieces of information. In librarianship, you work with all kinds of different media. And obviously, librarianship is a field that has lots of structure applied to it. So, yeah. In my retirement, what I've tried to do is actually apply some of those skills that I had in my work life, a daily regimen, if you will. So, I see myself at this point, the chair and the mat at my daily gym at this point. Reading Dutch letters of a Dutch artist, and then reading a Dutch novel that takes place in Wales, and connecting that Wales theme to watching a Welsh TV series, and it keeps me very motivated and keeps me sort of intellectually active, I feel. Yeah. So that's what I was trying to portray.
So this image says something about who you are. It talks about your identity visually.
That's what I hoped it to say, yes.
Yeah, it does. Definitely does. Yeah, it's very, very, very good. Very good. Thank you. Thank you so much for submitting it. Especially because you say you found it difficult, you know. So, and then this submission is Wendy's submission. So, Wendy, would you like to say something about this image?
Okay, I don't know anything really about photography, for starters. And I love taking photographs. So I was just getting ready to go out the door, and I was after being speaking to my daughter. So I was going to my yoga class, and I lay back on the couch. And the cushion there is Frida. So it's not set up. I lay back, the cushion was there, and that was just the way it was. And the dog popped up to have a look at, to see what was going on. I love color, as you can see. I have the hat on and all the rest of it. I'm in the dark color today, which is unusual, but I guess that's it. And I just love the way the cushion it's just great. The dog looking up.
I particularly love the way the cushion is upside down. It took me a little while to work out who it was, you know. It's brilliant. And again, everything that we've seen today uses what I call last week ambiguity. The image is open to interpretation depending on who's reading it, which is fantastic. It's a really great image, you know, and I love the dog in it too. It's like a visual question mark. It asks so many questions.
He just hopped up, you know, what are you doing, like with the phone up here. So it was just great. And I guess, you know, like for me, I was just, after being talking to my daughter, sent her the picture of myself before I went out the door, and the dog wanted to know what was going on. She had bought me the cushion, but it just happened to be there. I just lay back, and that was it.
There's something else, actually, that both yourself and Bridget, anyway, and Ed have all talked about, and that's the element of chance. That, you know, you can't So some people think that, you know, everything is pre-visualized in detail, and that, you know, that a good photographer should be able to pre-visualize everything and then just make it happen. And some photographers can, but a lot of photographers, what they do is they might have an area. Sorry, there's some rotten feedback there. Is that okay? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
So some photographers, they will set up the environment so that you know, they will get that lucky shot. So it's like that saying, you know, it's not that I'm lucky, but I find that the harder I work, the luckier I get. So, you know, you will very rarely get that great image on your first try, if that makes sense. Okay? And then the last image is mine. This is something that I got the inspiration for. An image that I got the inspiration from looking at one of the artists that we spoke about last week, Amelia Ullman. And Amelia Ullman's work, which is made for Instagram, I don't know whether you remember. I'm not sure if I mentioned last week, but she's interested in what's called the middle brow. And the middle brow is, so you've got the high brow, which is high culture, the low brow, which is the low culture. And then the middle brow are like people who, and she described it as people who try to use culture to acquire status. And I was just thinking about the way, you know, you go into a lot of fancy shops and they have this image of the Buddha, and you know, it's got nothing to do with Buddhism, but people buy it and they put it around. There's nothing wrong with that, I'm not judging them, but it's just, anyway, that was the thinking behind that image. So again, I'd like to thank everybody who submitted something, and they're great, well done. So now I'm going to move on to this week's theme, which is home. Subject is home, which is wide open. And I wrote a few notes down about home. Just, you know, it's important when you think about a brief or a theme that that you find a personal meaning in that brief in order to make work around it. So for me, the word home is something that is very personal. It can mean many different things to many different people. It could be a place that you call home. It could be the people that you share your life with there. Or it could be the place where you belong, or maybe the place, in my case, for a long, long time, home was somewhere I didn't feel like I belonged. It could be your friends. It could be your community. So, you know, it could be your family, and so on and so on. So when we're talking about home here, I want you to think wide open, whatever it means to you. So now, the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to show you some images. And this is where I'm going to ask you to try and, if you can, to try and do some of the work for me. So I'm going to start by sharing some of my photographs of home. I'm going to start by sharing some of my photographs of home. And I've deliberately arranged them in a certain order. And I want you to pay attention to the change in the sort of image that I'm showing you, okay? Because I'll be asking questions later. All right? Okay? I can't see your faces on screen, Sharon, so you might have to.
Okay.
Okay. So I'm going to say very little about these images because I want people on the call here to try and have a look at them and respond to them. And there's a reason I'm doing that. I want you to think about the images. You know, there's no point in me sharing work and explaining it all to you. So everybody's going to have see something slightly different in each image. So the first image is this one here. Okay. Mm-hmm. Can you see it?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So take a little bit of time, have a look at it. And then if you think you have something to respond to, to respond to it, how would you read the photograph? What does it say to you? What can we tell from this image? What's going on here? Those sort of questions. Okay? So, one at a time, feel free to respond. Or not.
Well, I tell you what I like about it.
That's funny.
Do just from, you know, I love the moon in the back. I love darkness and then this light. And then I don't know why or whatever, but those circles there in the center.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like it's bringing the light into the home.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what I see.
Very good. Yeah. Anybody else?
I like the fact that there's a light on in the house.
Yeah.
And there's cars parked, so it's either a family or
yes,
but they're safe and at home.
Yes. 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 Anybody else?
Hi, Brian. Ed here.
Yeah, go ahead, Ed.
Even though there's a good amount of light, it also appears very ominous to me.
Very ominous, yeah. Like I said, there's no correct interpretation. So what you're seeing here is that all images have a different meaning to everybody that looks at them. The audience bring their own meaning to the image. Okay, so I think that's a fair reading of that image. It's nighttime. Anybody else? We can move on now. You know, if you don't, you know, but if you'd like to say something, if you'd like to contribute, feel free.
Yeah. Hello?
Yeah, go ahead.
Can you hear me? Yeah.
I can hear you.
Yeah. Okay. No, the immediate image comes to me as being a house up a mountain, completely alone. And the one thing I wonder about is why is the light? Is there someone sick? Is somebody visiting?
Yeah.
No lights downstairs.
Yeah.
And it tells a story in itself, I think. No.
Yes.
But then again, some houses are built upside down. They have the living quarters upstairs. So that's the other side of that question.
Yeah.
So that's what I think about it.
Very good. Okay. So this is what I'm talking about. I'm deliberately sharing images without text or without context to make you work as a viewer, to read the image, to find a story in the image. And every single one of those interpretations is a valid interpretation. Okay. So I'm going to move on now. So to the next image is this image. Okay. Take a couple of minutes, read, interpret, and then fire away and contribute. Tell me what it says to you. What can we tell about this person? Or this situation?
He looks worried, waiting in a waiting room or something, looking worried.
Mm-hmm. Very good, Shea. Yeah. Very good. Go ahead there, yeah? I know your name's not Drew, but go ahead.
That's fine, yeah. That's fine. I just think there should be a bubble coming out of her saying, why are you insisting on taking the photo?
Yes, yes, yes.
He looks pretty not in the humor.
Yes. Say, you know? Yes, definitely, yes. Anybody else?
The audience are just fairly intense.
She's really making eye contact with the camera, with us, the viewer, isn't she? Yeah. Okay. I'll just move on, okay, to the next one. So think about this as a standalone image, but also think about this compared to the last two. Okay.
Much warmer. It's a much warmer image.
Yeah.
Obviously, it's color.
Yeah.
But it's, you know, the setting is quite warm. But we're very much in the presumably the mother's point of view.
Mm-hmm.
Looking at this really nice scene.
Yeah. Yeah. You can see the child in the background. Yeah.
Identify the people.
Say that again, Pascal.
We don't know who the people are. We don't see the painting.
Yeah.
And the difficult to know who took the photo.
Yeah.
And the woman's face is in profile, so she doesn't want probably her face shown.
Yeah.
So yeah. It's quite private. It's very private. In
the yes, it is. Yeah. Yeah, it's a private, it's a quiet moment.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Would anybody else like to contribute, Ed, or will I move on?
Brian, I'll say Ed here.
Yeah, go ahead, Ed.
To me, there's a lot of ambiguity given the angle of the woman's face. I can't really tell what her mood is.
Yes.
I mean, there's light on her. There's a lot of positive light there, but
yeah.
I for the life of me, I can't tell what's going on.
Yeah. Exactly. We can see her very clearly from the side, but we can't see her facial expression. We don't know who the people are in the background, and we don't know what the relationship is. So, yes. Okay. So again, don't have to answer now, but think about the difference. It's not just, Bridget, you're right about how warm it is, but that's not what I'm thinking about, the difference between this image and the last two. Okay. So, it might become clear when we go to the next one, okay? Maybe not. So, what sort of scene is this? What can we tell from the image?
Dog is boss.
There's a lack of two focus.
Yes.
The focus is the dog.
Yes.
And the lady is out of focus, and she probably just woke up or something.
Yes. Mm. Yes. Would you say it's morning or evening? No.
The purple gives the dog a sense of royalty, I think, you know, that he's, as the other person said, he's the boss, he's the king.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah.
That's the purple.
Yeah,
my mind anyway, you know.
Okay, yeah. No, they're all, you know, there's no right or wrong way to interpret all these, and that's the point I'm making. Okay, just this was the image I meant to show next.
Enjoying the great outdoors.
Yeah. Mm. What's going on?
Yeah.
What do you think is going on in the picture?
I don't like this meal.
Yeah.
Or anticipation of what they're going to eat.
Yeah.
Now maybe she's about to, I don't know, I assume she's a she, and maybe she's about to feed a child. It looks like a child food.
Yeah.
Maybe.
So do you see? So can anybody, you might not, look, just think about the first two images, the house and then the lady who's making eye contact. Yeah. And the amount of information in those two images compared to this image.
Mm. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what I was hoping, I didn't check the order before I put it together. That the last image is a kind of an aberration, but what I was driving at was, as you reduce the information in a frame, as you play what you put in and what you leave out, you make the viewer work harder. But by working harder, the narrative becomes much richer. That's really what I'm driving at here. We're going to see that over and over and over again. So quite often when we talk about portraits, for instance, we think of that second image. You know, somebody sitting there smiling at the camera. But very often, the more interesting photographs that are made about people are the ones where you can't see their face, where you, you know, their identity is withheld, or a lot of information is maybe there's a lot of information in the image, but there's key pieces of information that are missing. And you have to make that information up yourself. You have to find it for yourself. It also means that you can refer that image to, you know, you can see your own life in that image. You know, I think it was Pascal who was talking about maybe she's feeding the baby. I don't know whether you have children, but now that I have children, I can totally see that narrative in that image, you know? So that's really where I'm driving at. So when we're thinking about photographs, it's as much about, you've got to play with the frame, okay? So it's about what you include inside the frame, but it's often about, it's as much about what you do not include. So you give visual clues and you ask the viewer to join the dots to make the clues up. Okay? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Are you all still with me? Am I going too slow? Yeah.
Do you think we should leave a little bit of mystery?
No, good.
No, we're fine.
Okay.
Do you think we should leave a bit of mystery in the photograph? Is that what you mean?
I think that's a very good question. It's a hard one to say yes or no to. So sometimes, so these are all images that I, these are all my images. And they're all, sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work. So you've got to try. In other words, that there is no prescription. So if you want to talk about your family life or the circumstances or the place you live, you've got to play with the frame. You've got to think about what you include and what you don't include, you know? So I don't know whether that answers your question. It's not a yes or no answer.
No, I wasn't asking a question, really. I was just positing. That's what's needed.
Yeah. It's a great, look, do you know what? I think it's a great thing to be remembering when you're making images.
Yeah.
And sometimes, you know, I think it was, I don't know whether everybody knows Henri Cartier-Bresson. He was a very famous photographer from the 20th century, one of the founding members of Magnum. And he said, your first 20,000 photographs are your worst. So you've got to make a lot of images to get good ones. So, you know, if you're looking at your photographs, what I'm saying to you here is, you're looking at your photographs and going, they're not good enough, or, you know, well, they don't like this and they don't like that. It's normal. And you just keep on working. Keep on going. So I'm going to move on, okay? Just quickly through the next two. Next two or three. Okay, so I'm going to go on past this. So really what I'm talking about here again is lack of detail, ambiguity, but still telling you something about who lives here. You can fill in the blanks yourself. You can imagine the story behind that image. You know, again, there's lots of questions. Is that a swing in the background? Are there children in the house? Have they just had lunch? Is that a salad bowl? Why have the flowers blown over? What does this image represent? Has there been a row? You know, has there been an argument? And so on and so on. So that's what I'm really driving at. Okay. Who can tell me what's going on here? Say that again, Wendy.
I said it looks like the end of the day.
Yes. Okay, so I'm going to include a couple of images that I've shot in the house here with my phone. And the reason I'm doing that is because when we get on to talking about some of the work later on, when we think about photographing the home or our family, we automatically start thinking about, I've got to clean up. I've got to reorganize the house. I can't take a photograph in here because of all the stuff that's in the way. Okay? But look at the amount of visual detail, the amount of visual information that you can read in this image. You know, it's obviously early morning, new baby. Look at the stuff on the table, the vitamins, there's medication there. Look at the mess and the way the stuff is in the way. You know, it's in the way of the camera, shot at a low angle. It all adds interest. So there can be a sort of natural, you know, I suppose people automatically think because, you know, we're used to being told, you know, the Kodak moment, that if you're photographing yourself or your family or whatever, that you put on your best public face. That isn't often the most interesting face, you know? So this is the next one, okay? Same thing, okay? Okay, so, you know, I mean, I'll tell you the story behind this. This is a new baby. You just pulled everything off the shelves. We weren't long living in the house and trying to organize everything. And so, but you know, you can tell the amount of visual information there, it tells you something about what it's like to live with a new baby. You know, I'm nearly done with my family now. there was a specific reason I included this. Have a look. This is my son. Have a look. And you tell me what you can read it.
He's tired of me taking photos of him, Brian.
That's for sure. Actually, he loves the camera.
What are you joking?
I'll tell you what it is. I took it for a specific reason. Look at his face. You see the scar?
Yeah.
Okay, I wanted the scar. It's fresh. He cut himself. We had to go to hospital with him. So, you know, I'm thinking about, I suppose, one of the reasons that we quite often make photographs of our family, and it's a very valid reason, is to remember, to document a moment, to remember. So the reason that I have so many photographs of my family is that, first of all, I'm a photographer, and second of all, I'm obsessive about, I have to take a photograph of that in case I forget it. You know, not that you ever would, but, you know, anyway. This one from last week. Can you see it? Would anybody like to have a read it?
Good idea.
Thank you. Okay. Again, it's obscure in the. I could have taken a photograph of my son and, you know, stood him in the center of the image, or stood him to one side and obeyed the rule of thirds, and I was just sitting there thinking, you know, that I wear glasses, and you know, I wonder what it would look like if I stuck my glasses in front of the camera and asked them to get down and give me a thumbs up behind it. And I took 5, 6, maybe 10 images and got one. So again, there's that idea that it isn't just the first image, you know. So okay, I'll just move on. Okay, I really included this because I wanted to tell you about, if you notice the door, the doorway, the top of the doorway, okay? A lot of photography schools, I suppose, you know, will tell you that everything has to be horizontal, and, you know, that you know, look at the carpet at the bottom. Do you see the lines of the carpet at the bottom, that, you know, it's not square, and the door lintel is not square at the top. In other words, the frame is tilted slightly. And I wanted to say to you that that is what is called, there is actually a name for that, but that is not bad photography, okay? Some people are perfectionists and everything has to be perfect, but that is actually a recognized aesthetic in photography called the snapshot aesthetic. And the snapshot aesthetic came about when cheap cameras became available and people took their cameras out to the beach or to the park or to the zoo, and they started goofing around and photographing. So, you know, your photographs do not have to be perfect. That snapshot aesthetic is a sign of intimacy. You know, we don't think about, when we're photographing our family, we don't see all that stuff, you know, in the photographs. It's not about having everything perfectly lined up. It's about communicating an emotion, I suppose. Anyway, and for me, that, you know, was just back in March. It was my son's 5th birthday, and that balloon just seemed to say it all. So don't be, if you're taking photographs and you're looking at them afterwards and beating yourself up, and I still do this. I hesitated about putting this in because I was like, oh, that line is crooked. But actually, it's not about everything being perfect. It's about trying to convey a mood or convey a feeling. Okay? I'm going to move on now. I wanted to say something about my dad in this image. It's his apartment. He used to live in this apartment in Dublin, and he's a neat freak, okay? And one of the things that we're going to be doing at the end of this is you're going to get an assignment, and your assignment is going to be about your home, the people that you live in, and so on and so on. And I want you to try and step back. It's difficult. If you can, step back and start to notice where you live. You don't have to do it 24/7. Just take a few minutes every day and notice those small details that say something about the people that live in that house, okay? Same thing. Again, I've withheld a lot of information, but you can tell a lot from this image. This is, again, my dad, Fred. He's obviously in hospital. He's obviously unwell. And it's part of an ongoing series. Again, because I'm a documentary photographer, it's about making work about my father before there's no more work made about him, you know. I'm interested in him. I'm interested in him. And anybody who, you know, is a, you know, also, there's something we said about hands. Hands are very important in terms of portraiture. you can make a portrait of somebody without showing their face. I wanted to show his hands because to me, they speak so much about him, okay? This is when he was in the hospital. He loves crosswords, or he did love crosswords. I don't think he does them so much anymore. But, you know, I just, these were all taken on my phone. I was in hospital with him, and I just stayed with him and photographed. And it's only later on when you figure out what you want to say that you start to edit the work and think about what way you might order it, and you know which image comes first, and so on. Okay. So this is him. I could have put that image first, but I deliberately didn't. Okay. So this brings me to something else I want to talk about. Back in the early days of Hollywood, when movies were new, okay, and movie making was a new discipline, they came up with this system for how to sequence the shots in an image, the continuity system. And if you still use today, every TV program, every documentary you see, every movie you look at will use the continuity system. And one of the aspects of the continuity system is they always had an establishing shot at the beginning. Okay, and this would be a typical establishing shot. So, you know, you've been shown one of the characters in the story here, and obviously the text at the top tells you something about him. Okay, so this would be an what you might call an establishing shot. And as we go through the work that we're going to look at, we're going to see that over and over again. Okay, so as well as an establishing shot, you would get detail, you would get a headshot, and so on and so on. So again, this is my son. This might be an establishing shot. Maybe if I was going to tell a story about him, I would start with his image. And again, this is another image of my son that I took this week. And I wanted to show you this because it's imperfect. You can see that his head breaks the frame at the top, which is a no-no for some, you know, perfectionists. And also you can't see his face, but I think that makes it more interesting. Okay. I'm just conscious that of time. So now I want to show you this piece of work. It's called Pictures from Home by a photographer called Larry Sultan. And this is a fabulous piece of work. It's a piece of work that he made in the 70s and 80s. It's Pictures from Home. It's about his parents, his relationship with his parents and their relationship with each other, the place that they live. It's just a fabulous piece of work. So again, continuity system, establishing shot. You know, you're seeing the community that they live in, so you can tell something about their socioeconomic background. You can tell somebody, you know, you can tell something about them from where they live and so on and so on. There's a lot of information in this image, but you can't, I suppose a lot of it is withheld if you don't know the title of the work and you don't know what it's about. But if you do, you know, you've been given a lot of clues here that his parents are not working class, shall we say, okay? Again, what I would call another establishing shot, and you've been introduced to his father as one of the characters in the story. Is this all making sense? Are you all with me?
Yeah.
Feel free to jump in at any point.
Where is that?
Go ahead, sorry.
What part of the world is that?
It's in California. Larry Sultan was an American photographer, He grew up in California. The work is from these images are all from a piece of work called Pictures from Home, and I chose it because it's about home, family, and not that we live in the same kind of place, but you know, it. I suppose it's just an interesting piece of work because it's about the mundane, the ordinary, the everyday. So, yeah. This is a really interesting photograph, okay? It's his father, but what does it say? What can we read about his father from this image?
It looks like he's going to his daughter's wedding.
Yeah, looks like it could be. Yeah. Would you say he's happy?
No.
Neither. Hey, he looks...
Do a funeral?
Maybe a funeral, yeah. That's a really interesting reading, yeah. I would say that he looks unhappy. I would say that he looks discontent here. Yeah. And we're seeing him in his bedroom, which is an intimate space. And you can see all the other things. It's important as well to pick up on all the other things in the background, like the pictures, the clothes on the rack, you know. So you're being given, and see the stuff on the dressers here as well. You've been given all sorts of small visual clues that you can take away. And this work is made as a photo book. And what I really like about photo books is you can go back to the work again and again and again, and you'll see something in it that you didn't see before. Okay. So I want you to think establishing shot. Now we're being introduced to the characters. Okay. So this is his mother. Same thing. The second character in the story, we're being told something about her. We can read a lot into this image too, from her facial expression, the clothes she's wearing, the background. You know, there's a story here. Okay? Does anybody want to say anything? Okay. Save it for the next image. Okay. What does this image say about them?
They're matching.
Besides the fact that they're colorblind, what does it tell us about their relationship?
Yeah,
disconnect.
Possibly. Yeah, possibly. Yeah. It's hard to be sure, but
he
wants to be seen, but he doesn't. He wants to get on with his thing, but she loves being photographed and seen, maybe.
Mm.
But he doesn't. We see his back. And we see her full.
Yes, yes, yes. He didn't look comfortable. Yeah, you're right, Pascal. I don't think he was ever comfortable being photographed.
No, no. Mm. He wants to watch his game.
Mm. Yeah.
And be left alone.
Yeah. And I suppose there's two relationships in this image. One is the relationship between the man and the woman in the image, and the other relationship is their relationship between the photographer and the subjects.
Yeah.
Right? So she's making eye contact with the photographer. And when you read the book, I think it's fair to say that his mother and himself had a very loving relationship, and himself and his father had a more complicated relationship. Okay? Yeah. So,
there could be another relationship in
there. Say that again?
There could have been another relationship in there, with the relationship with the TV.
Yeah, possibly.
Mm-hmm. So often when somebody's very into their sport, they're so focused, and that becomes a serious relationship.
Yeah. So you see, what we're doing here is, see how much we're talking about the ordinary here. Okay, we've been talking about this for an hour now, about ordinary, mundane, everyday scenes. So, you know, it just shows you that the real drama is right in front of you. The real interesting stories are right in front of you. Okay, so just if anybody wants to comment on this image, please speak up. I included it because I wanted to show you this stuff in the foreground. You know, all their possessions. So that's another way that you can talk about the person in the image, or talk about yourself through the stuff that you include in the image. You know, look at there's a pot of plant on the left, and then there's the stuff in the kitchen.
Yeah.
Pot of plants in the corner, pictures on the wall, the cuckoo clock, the kettle. The kettle is right there in the middle of the frame, you know, or just slightly off center. Mm. And all that, to me, just tells you that he's embedded in that household, you know. Whereas a lot of people would go, I don't want to include all that stuff. I'm just going to move that out of the way. By the time you move all that out of the way, what's going to happen to the people you want to photograph? They're gone. Yeah, the moment's gone. Okay. So, you know, I suppose we're surrounded by all this stuff. You see it all the time. And then it should be in the photographs, I think. Okay.
Yeah.
What about this? Think about this image compared to the compared to the one of the man in the bed on his own.
Oh yeah, it's the same bedroom.
Same bedroom, yeah.
Mm. Yeah, same. Is that his parents as well?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
They're sitting on the other side of the bed.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. What do you think is going on? They could be having an argument.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. As they look more human.
Human, yeah.
Yeah, more human, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Everything looks crooked to me in that picture.
It does, actually. The stuff on the wall. Look at the pictures on the wall.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Is the room neat and tidy?
No.
No.
Well, the bed
not
is
bad.
Yeah. Yeah.
But there are folded clothes on the bed.
Yeah. Yeah. So there's a lot that you can read there. Sorry? Will I move on?
What's the photographer doing in the bedroom? That's where I'm wondering.
Good question. Good question. Very valid question. Yeah. Yeah. Well, I suppose they are his parents, and yeah, maybe that you can see why.
Yeah.
His father didn't really feel comfortable being photographed there. You know. But
somebody's sick. Is one of them sick?
Possibly. Yeah. Possibly. Maybe it's more. It's funny when I read that his mother might be ill. Yeah. When you say that.
Yeah.
Particularly, I suppose, because it's daylight. You know, but then there could be morning time, and who knows? But you know, it's a movable feast, isn't it? It could be lots of different things. So keep that in mind when you're working on this week's assignment, okay?
Okay.
So here again is what I'm talking about withholding information, if you like. It's it's about what you include and what you don't include. So again, this is his father, but he hasn't shown us his face. Yeah. But it still says something about him, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Okay. What does it say about him?
The businessman for his parents.
Yeah. 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 Exactly.
He has some money.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he doesn't like to be disturbed reading his paper.
Yes. Yes. Could be. It's a very rich image, I think. Okay?
Yeah.
Who is this? His mother or his father?
Mother.
Mother.
Yeah. You know, again, it's just enough information, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. But again, there's so much that we don't see in this image, but we can make a lot of sense from it, can't we?
There's no indication in the photograph or in the book, is there, as to the year these were taken?
I think it was Larry Sultan died in the middle 90s, and I think these were all, this is at a certain time. It's interesting. It's an interesting piece of work, because I recommend you look at it. When you get the presentation, there's a link to his website that explains those texts. His family, or his parents, basically became, like, if you like, a metaphor for what America was going through at the time. It was like the big, you know, it was the end of the industrial age. I think they were all made in the late 80s or maybe early 90s.
Yeah. The wallpaper and the decor looks a bit old. That's why I asked.
You know? Television was definitely 60s or 70s.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
And then if you looked at the guy with the baseball hat in the telly, you know. Anyway.
Same question, man or woman?
Woman.
Woman.
Anybody else?
Man, I'd say.
Could be a man.
Man, yeah.
She has the toes of somebody who has worn a lot of high heels.
Yeah.
He's actually his father. I don't know why he has to say that. But again, you know, there isn't a right or wrong reading of an image. You know, when you see the book or you see the website, it actually has this is another thing we might discuss next week, how important text is with image. So there is a caption that says, Dad's feet. But again, I want you to think about, he's obviously made lots of photographs of his dad, but they're not all face on. And this is another way that you can photograph somebody in your life. You know, not necessarily their feet. Maybe you don't want to show their feet. Maybe you want to show their hands. You know, whatever. Maybe you want to show the side of their face instead of their, maybe you want to show the back of their head. But again, it's such, I think that's such a rich image.
Rich.
Yeah.
there's so much to be read within that, you know, the thing about all this work, I think, is you can come back to it again and again and see things in it that you didn't see before. I've said that already, but, you know, you're never going to come away with a reading from this image first time. There's always more to be had, which is really, to me, is really fantastic. Okay. Mm-hmm. So this is a bedside table. Who wants to hazard a guess on whether it's his father's or his mother's?
Mother's, I'd say.
The mother.
Anybody else?
I'd say the mother as well.
Mother.
It is the mother. Okay. But look at the clues that are there. It is the mother. Yeah, it is the mother. And the drawer gives it away, you know, and then the novel.
Yeah.
And also the glasses case.
Romance novel.
Say that again, Ed. I didn't hear you. Ed. Okay. I really find, I think this is a blood pressure cuff.
Yeah.
In the corner. Yeah. Again, you know, that's a really interesting thing to include. A visual clue. Now we're learning something about their state of health, maybe. You know?
Yeah.
Okay. Father's side of the bed. What does it say about him? What can we tell about him?
He has health problems as well.
Yeah.
Well, that's a gardening thing. That's a gardening thing.
Yes.
And it's all about his son.
Yeah. Yeah. It says something about the relationship with his, I think we have two sons.
Yeah.
Sons. I think the can in the corner is interesting. Nods only, oxalis control for mitochondrial lawns only. I think that's really interesting because in the book, I think there's lots of images of the, you're seeing this image on its own, but there's lots of images of the perfect lawn. And his father was a golfer as well. I think he was a bit obsessed with having the perfect lawn. And actually, that's a very common thing where I live. Mm-hmm. There's an awful lot of people around me who have, you know, a billiard table lawn. So I don't know whether that's a man thing, but you know, it obviously says something about his father anyway, that stickler for a lawn. And I know my father-in-law, for instance, is a stickler for the lawn as well. You know, he goes out like with napalm for the daisies and things like that, you know, so it reminds me of him too, you know. Okay, moving on. Storytelling. The golden rule. Show, don't tell. It's not as easy as it sounds. But that's, if does anybody here do creative writing, for instance? Is anybody a writer? It's one of the, you may have come across that in terms of creative writing. Show, don't tell. So it's a kind of a way of summing up what I said earlier on about, you know, playing with the frame and leaving things out and giving visual clues maybe. Not for every image, but That's what I'm really driving at. So when you're thinking about making your images this week to bring along next week, try and remember that. You won't remember all this stuff. It's okay. You'll have the presentation to go back to. And particularly, I like when I'm making work, I like to look at images. I like to, and that's why I'm giving you things to look at. Okay? So show, don't tell is a central thing in storytelling, whether it's visual storytelling or, and by that I mean photography or moving image or written.
How do we show the images next week?
Well, if you submit them into Bridget there, she'll send them on to me and I'll include them in the presentation.
Okay.
Okay.
So I'll send an email after today's session and I'll include the presentation in it and my email just so you have it and then you can send them to me.
Thank you.
Okay. So the second piece of work I wanted to show you today, it's much shorter than the last two. It's by a photographer whose name is Dinu Li. He's of Chinese origin but lives in the UK, okay? It's a piece of work that he made. I'll tell you a little bit about the work. It's called Secret Shadows, okay? And he set out to make a piece of work that portrayed Chinese migrant workers. But they're illegal immigrants, so he couldn't show their face. So he had to come up with a a visual strategy where he could say something about them in images, but could show their face, because obviously they'd be arrested and deported. Okay, so it's the same kind of idea. So again, you're going to get this. We won't labour the point by reading every single image. I'll just mention it. But again, you know, you can see this image tells us a lot about the occupant, about this the occupant of this room. It tells us a lot about their financial circumstances, their socioeconomic circumstances, and you can see the Chinese calendar on the wall. It even tells us something about their ethnic background. Okay, they're obviously not well off. They're obviously not rich. And when you have the other thing that you always have with a piece of work like this is you have a title and you usually have an artist statement that give you some sort of context to read the images. So, same here, okay? These are very powerful images. So you say an awful lot without saying. These typify show, don't tell, okay? So it's left up to you to fill in the blanks. If anybody wants to say anything, please feel free to jump in. Okay. Okay. That's the last one, that's it. Now, quickly, I want to show you a piece of work by another photographer who I mentioned earlier on, Alex Soth. His first body of work was called Sleeping by the Mississippi. It's about a road trip that he took along the Mississippi in the southern states of America. You might know him, Ed, for instance. I don't know if you've ever come across him. He is a fantastic visual storyteller. And, so here again, you have an establishing shot that asks a lot of questions. Who lives in a house like this? You know, there's a lot of visual information there. You can, you know, it's obviously winter. I wouldn't say that this person is very well off, but, you know, they look like an interesting character maybe, you know, and so on and so on. And then we get to meet the person who lives in this house. And again, with a caption with this, I can't recall what it is, but, you know, it's obviously a very interesting person. And his images are, I find his images are just really rich, okay? So they're the first two images in the book. What about this image? Have a go at tell me something about this image. Look like sitting in that chair.
Yeah.
There's only one person sitting in that chair.
Who?
The man himself. That looks like his favorite chair.
Yeah.
Reminds me of the chair in Frasier. Do you remember that?
Yeah. His dad's chair.
Yeah.
Dad's chair, yeah. Martin's chair. You see the use of colour here? And, you know, how garish that chair is against the green background. I suppose what I would say about that is, what's going on here is he's making a reference here to colour photography and art photography, okay? What you have to realise is that up until very recently, and still even today, some photographers will consider that art photography is black and white photography. But in the 70s, an American photographer came along, his name escapes me now. I included him in the submission. He was the first art photographer to be given a show where he used colour photography. Colour was available to ordinary people for 10 or 15 years before it entered the gallery. This particular photographer, whose name escapes me right now, God, I can't remember his name, it's just gone. When you look at his work is very rich in colour. So I always read this as a reference to him, to his work. Another image by Alex Soth from a piece of work called Niagara. It's about Niagara Falls. And it's actually the very first image. This is an establishing shot in the photo book. And I would like you to think about the image for a minute and think about Niagara Falls. And if you were going to go and make a piece of work about Niagara Falls, what would you include as your first photograph? What comes to mind when you think of Niagara Falls?
Water.
Yeah. Why do you think he didn't include the waterfall first? Okay, I'll tell you why. It's because this piece of work is based in Niagara Falls, and Niagara Falls has two other things, as well as being famous as a waterfall and as a you know a scenic location. It is also famous for two other things. It's famous in America as a place where people go on honeymoon, and it's also famous as a place where people go to commit suicide. Okay, and Alex Scott's work is really located not about the spectacle of the waterfall. He's interested in the people who go there to get married and have their honeymoon there. It's a place where people go. So the waterfall does feature in it, but it doesn't come first. Okay, and again, if you read that image, it tells you something. It's a motel. It looks like a cheap motel to me, but maybe not cheap. You know. There's two people concerned. This image speaks to me about two people, you know, maybe romance, looks like swans, or maybe a heart, and so on. Mm. So it's a really strong image to me. But interesting, you have to take time to stop to read these images, to notice them. Okay, and of course, if you were seeing this in a gallery, it would be big, so you couldn't miss it. Okay. This is another image of his from a piece of work called Broken Manual. But again, it's a really interesting image. And again, would anybody like to take a shot at interpreting it? What might you read in this image?
Is he asleep or is he dead?
Very good question. I don't know.
He looks like he's thinking.
Say that again, Wendy.
His brow is furrowed.
Yeah.
And
yes. Yeah. Yeah.
It looks to me someone was exhausted from working hard outside.
Yeah. 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 It's an interesting image, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's an interesting image because, you know, a lot of people, including myself, would not have taken that kind of image, you know, but he did, you know. So I suppose when you think about, and I'm not expecting anybody here, including myself, to make this kind of work, you know, in a week. Alex Soth has been doing this for years. He's a member of Magnum, which is probably the preeminent photo agency. He has a huge body of work. So, you know, don't feel intimidated. Just enjoy the images, drink them in. This might be the last image. Yes. Okay. So this is the last image. So we're just finished. Okay. So has anybody got any questions before I move on to the assignment?
No.
Have I made myself clear?
Yep.
Yes.
Ready? Yeah. Okay. So I'm just going to talk about the assignment and then we'll wrap up. Okay. This week's assignment is to make a photograph, or maybe a series of photographs, that tells your story. Doesn't have to be your story. You can invent a persona. But some things to consider. Think about what you include in the frame and also what you deliberately exclude. So, you know, like if you think about that image of the bowl and the hand and the spoon, you know, there's a lot of information is not inside that frame, but there's still... It leaves you wondering. So that's why I'm saying, think about what you include and what you exclude. Think about the setting of your story. Review the images presented here. I'm saying to do that because I find that if I'm trying to make work, it helps if I look at work. Now people sometimes say, whoa, that's copying. Don't worry about that. Just enjoy them, look at them, think about them. It puts you in the right state for when you come to make your own work. Then introduce your characters. Like I said, think about your establishing shot. Is it going to be, if you're making a piece about where you live or your house or whatever, are you going to show us the front of your house, the front door? It's up to you. You don't have to have an establishing shot either. And your establishing shot does not have to come first. The great thing about rules is they're made to be broken. The two most important things with this assignment are, to experiment and play, make as many mistakes as you can, okay? Mm-hmm. Because there's no such thing as failure, there's only feedback. But most of all, have fun doing it. Okay?
Okay.
And just to recap, you're going to get the presentation, but I'll just recap. What we looked at today was Larry Sultan, Pictures from Home, Dinu Lee, Secret Shadows, and Alex Soth, we looked at Sleeping by the Mississippi, Niagara, and Broken Manual. Does anybody have anything that they'd like to say before I close off?
And then we just follow these guidelines here.
Like I said at the beginning, home is wide open, Wendy. So home can be the house you live in, the people you live with, the place that you belong, the place that you don't belong. It's wide open. So everybody should come up with, think and reflect on what home means to them and what they would like to say about home. Do I need to put that down in writing?
No.
Okay. Okay. So who's up for a challenge? I'm going to stop screen sharing now so you can see me, okay? Hang on. Where's my cursor gone? Hang on. Okay. Can you see me?
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. Everyone clear?
Yes.
So, is Bridget, would you like to say anything just before I close off?
Just to say thanks very much for that, Brian, and thanks to everyone for joining us today. I work with Age and Opportunity as well. This is why I've been chiming in case you're wondering. And hopefully we'll see you all next week. And if you get a chance to experiment, as Brian said, you know, really love to see your work and to share it. And, you know, I think at the moment we're all, you know, really in need of some creativity in our lives. And obviously that's what Bealtaine at Home is all about, is trying to kind of access that while we're still, you know, kind of dealing with everything else that's going on. So I'm sure some of your work will probably reflect that and some might not. But it'd be really interesting to see what everybody comes back with.
Thank you, Bridget. I can't emphasize enough that I believe, even though I'm probably my own worst critic, there is no such thing as failure, okay? There is no feedback. So don't be afraid to make mistakes. Don't be afraid to get it wrong. And don't be afraid to send in the work that you feel didn't work. You know, send in the stuff that you think, oh my God, I tried to do it, but it didn't work. Send it in. Let's have a chat about it, okay? I can't emphasize that enough. Have fun. Play. Experiment. You know, we couldn't get a better time now for taking time out to be creative. Just before all this happened, I was really in a bad place, in that I was looking for every opportunity to run away from actually sitting down to make work. Mm-hmm. And since this has happened, it's made me get back into the studio and it's made me get back to making work. And just stick with it. Stick with it and something will come out the other end, okay? I wanted to say thanks to everybody who came along today. It means so much to me. You know, because you guys are keeping me going as well. It's giving me something to build my week around, you know. And when we finish today, I'll be already thinking about what we might talk about next week. Like I said as well, if you can have a think about what you might like to get, you know, you might not have it now, but you can send it into Bridget during the week, okay? What would you like to come away from these sessions? You know, what would you hope to achieve? What would you like to talk about? Send me anything like that, and I'll try and include it in the presentation. I'll try and build it in, okay? And then I'd just like to finish by again thanking Agent Opportunity for giving me this opportunity. I'd like to mention the Bealtaine Art Hall Festival. There's lots of other good things going on the website. And the sponsors, the Agent Opportunity, Creative Ireland, the HSC, and the Arts Council. And I look forward to seeing you.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks, everybody.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.